Do you know that the renowned European mathematician Leonardo of Pisa or Leonardo Pisano, better known under the nickname Fibonacci, son of Bonaccio, stayed and studied in the central Maghreb, more particularly in Béjaïa, city of the current Algeria? But before speaking about this European mathematician, it is necessary to understand certain important historical events, the strong tendencies and the general context of the 11th and 12th centuries in the Mediterranean.
The first Quranic verses revealed to the Prophet of Islam emphasize the importance of reading, study and the quest for knowledge. The first Muslims, for whom the ink of the scholar is more sacred than the blood of the martyr, strive to place the quest for knowledge in their body of spiritual and ethical values. They keep, in particular, in memory the hadiths of the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, which encourage the search for knowledge throughout the entire existence, from the cradle to the grave. These hadiths encourage Muslims to undertake journeys to distant lands if necessary for this purpose. Some sovereigns, on the strength of these recommendations and sometimes also out of intellectual curiosity, distinguished themselves particularly.
This is the case of Caliph al-Ma'mun, passionate about ancient Greece. Who had the first astronomy observatory installed on the heights of Baghdad in 829 after the birth of Christ and created the House of Wisdom in 832? This open living library brought together scholars from all over the world belonging to different ethnic groups, languages, religions, and cultures, protected by the Caliph patron. Sheltered from financial hassles, they devoted themselves body and soul to their discipline. Works from the Sasanian Empire, Indian Civilization, and Byzantine Empire were translated from Persian, Sanskrit, Ancient Greek into Arabic. The translations of these works were sometimes redone two or three times, until a satisfactory translation was obtained. Whole sections of knowledge that had never been brought into contact with each other, because they came from different civilizations, emerged under a single language, the Arabic language, then a major language of knowledge and communication across the planet. Euclid, Archimedes, to name a few, resurfaced. One wonders what Greco-Roman culture could Europe today claim if it had not had access to this heritage of ancient Greece through the Arab-Muslim civilization.
Until the 10th century, the scholars of the Muslim Empire, an empire which extended over three continents, Asia, Africa, Europe, assimilated, by the permanent effort of translation, the knowledge of the ancients. They digested this knowledge, appropriated it, added critical commentaries to it, and they pursued research to the point of innovating, thus creating new disciplines such as algebra or trigonometry. This is how the great mathematician Abu Ja'far Muhammad ben Musa al-Khawarizmi, also a geographer, astrologer, astronomer whose mother tongue was Persian because he was born in the territory of what is now Uzbekistan, spent most of his life in Baghdad, within the House of Wisdom. His Latinized name was the origin of the word algorithm and the title of one of his works, abbreviated calculation by restoration and comparison, was the origin of the word algebra. The dynamic impelled in Baghdad, House of Wisdom plus patronage was duplicated on a more or less large scale throughout the territory of Muslim civilization. Scientific centers radiated.
The Maghreb was not on the sidelines. It played the role of transmission belt of knowledge between the Middle East and Sicily-Sardinia on the one hand, and between Mesopotamia and the Iberian Peninsula on the other. The Maghreb had, in fact, very close ties with the Iberian Peninsula. Most of the inhabitants of the peninsula referred to as Moors in European literature are descended from the Arab Berbers of North Africa, the conquerors of Iberia. And when we take into account the genealogy on the maternal side of certain princes of the East, it happens that we also discover a Maghrebian origin. This is, for example, the case of Abderrahman, premier Umayyad founder of the Emirate of Cordoba, born in Damascus, nicknamed the Quraic Falcon, whose mother is Berber. His descendants reigned over a large part of the Iberian Peninsula for three centuries. It would perhaps be more accurate to qualify the Umayyad dynasty of Cordoba as the Maghrebian Umayyad dynasty. A land of exchanges, hospitality, and tolerance, the central Maghreb played a major role in the dissemination of knowledge in the Mediterranean. Scientific and literary personalities came to stay there to learn, document and discuss.
So much for the general context. What about the city of Béjaïa? The city of Béjaïa was a precursor of the intellectual movement in North Africa. It exerted a strong attraction at the Maghreb and Mediterranean level. At the crossroads of trade routes from the Levant, Europe and sub-Saharan Africa, Béjaïa, located on the site of the ancient Roman city, Saldé, was founded by Sultan En-Nasser of the Hammadite dynasty around 1067. Named En-Nasiriyah by the founding sultan, according to the historian and sociologist Ibn Khaldun, it ended up bearing the name of the tribe of the region, Bégate, which gave Béjaïa. Béjaïa, nicknamed Holy City or Little Mecca or Pearl of the Mediterranean, was the capital of a kingdom whose authority extended over all of Constantine and Algiers. Houses, mosques, colleges, universities, sumptuous palaces in a screen of greenery, the city attracted since the 10th century many Muslim, Christian and Jewish families who practiced trade or were interested in the disciplines of knowledge in which the scholars of the city excelled.
Its immense enclosure, its quays, its public buildings and its colleges were the admiration of foreigners. Many students flocked from everywhere to learn theology, jurisprudence, medicine, mathematics, astronomy, under the most distinguished masters of the time. This is what Laurent Charles Ferro, French military interpreter, indicated in the compendium of notices and memories of the Archaeological Society of the Province of Constantine in 1869. Laurent Charles Ferro, strongly impregnated with the history of the city, added, a scholar from Béjaïa, passing through Baghdad, replied in these terms to those who questioned him about his homeland, Baghdad. Cairo and all the cities of the Middle East are now eclipsed. There is none that can be compared to En-Nasiriyah, which enjoys, like this city, the pleasures of the sea, the land, and the waters of many springs. Its river resembles a silver serpent in its undulations. We are happy to live there. If you look at the countryside, you see it dotted with greenery, flowers, and fruit. If you consider the sea, you are charmed by the aspect of the waves which push each other to come to bathe it. You, who ask for the description of this city, wish that God fixes the stay there of your families and your children.
Home of light and erudition Béjaïa was for a long time the place where the youth came to draw the most varied knowledge. A few old manuscripts gave the biography of personalities from the Middle East and elsewhere who had stayed and taught in the Hammadite city. Then at the height of its splendor, there were scholars from Milianah, Delis, Biskra, Oran, Tlemcen, but also from Mursa, Malaga, Seville, Mosul, Isfahan. In the field of mathematics, the scholarly tradition of the region retained the names of local figures such as Ibn Hamad, died in 1230, Ali bin Muhammad bin Abdurrahman al-Tamimi, Abu Abdullah Muhammad bin Abu Bakr al-Mansur al-Khali. In Béjaïa, a high-level mathematical education was delivered, such as the Higher Algebra course of al-Qurashi, died in 1184, Andalusian of Seville origin, specialist in algebra and the science of inheritance. This was indicated by Messrs. Jamal Asani, mathematician, university professor and president of the study group on the history of mathematics in Béjaïa, as well as Dominique Valerian, professor of medieval history at the University of Paris 1 Pantheon Sorbonne, Maghreb specialist, in a joint publication entitled Mathematics, Commerce and Society in Béjaïa at the time of Leonardo Fibonacci's stay. They provided interesting information on the structuring of the scientific community of the city of Béjaïa between the 12th and 13th century.
It was in the context already mentioned that a commercial treaty was signed with the Republic of Pisa in 1166. In the Qissaria of Béjaïa, the European commercial district of the city, a new fondauk was installed where a certain Guglielmo Bonacci exercised, around 1175, the quality of merchant and customs notary public on behalf of the Order of Merchants of the Republic of Pisa.
Leonardo, his stay in Béjaïa, Guglielmo Bonacci decided to bring his very young son, whose working name was Leonardo Pisano, to Béjaïa to learn mathematics. Evolving in the atmosphere of Qissaria where numbers were important. Since it was a question of trade, Leonardo discovered the Indo-Arabic numeration. Unlike Roman numerals, Indo-Arabic numerals appeared powerful because they offered and continue to offer infinite possibilities of calculation. Leonardo studied in Béjaïa for several years and claimed to have received a wonderful education with the discovery of arithmetic, algebra and geometry. In Béjaïa, Leonardo put his knowledge into practice to solve everyday problems. For example, requested by a beekeeper, he calculated the growth of the export of beeswax used for the manufacture of candles, which ended up bearing the name of the city and being called Bougie in Italian or Bougie in French. During his mathematical operations, Fibonacci explained the calculations of sequences and limits.
According to a legend, it was during a trip to Algiers, named in the 11th century Algezair in Arabic and Zaire in Berber, that Leonardo, passing in front of the Great Mosque, built in 1097, would have told an Algiers Muslim scholar of his observations on the sequence known today as the Fibonacci sequence, and whose ratios between two consecutive numbers tended towards the value 1.618. The Muslim scholar would have replied to Leonardo that this value had been known from architects for a very long time. The builders of ancient Egypt had used it for the Pyramid of Cheops, for example. This value indicated beautiful proportions, and would be of divine inspiration. This was the famous golden number, mystical number with aesthetic properties.
Understanding what is hidden in a sequence of numbers remains a challenge for some mathematicians. The Fibonacci sequence arouses curiosity, as its properties are multiple. It intervenes in questions related to the dynamics of populations, to so-called fractal figures. By magnifying part of the object of the figure, we find the whole object. The Fibonacci sequence is also involved in plant geometry. The golden ratio and the Fibonacci sequence appear in nature. They are found, for example, in the branching of trees, the arrangement of leaves on a stem, the artichoke flower, the pine cone, the shell of a snail, the daisy, the sunflower have a number of petals corresponding to the Fibonacci sequence. Every living being seems organized according to mathematical principles, as disturbing as they are precise. Could the Fibonacci sequence and the golden ratio be symbols of universal harmony?
Transmission of knowledge, from Béjaïa to Pisa. Back in Pisa, Leonardo compiled all the mathematical knowledge amassed in Béjaïa and during his travels around the Mediterranean and tried to disseminate it. His first manuscript in Latin, which dealt with calculations and accounting, dated from 1202 and was entitled the Liber Abaci, which made him then famous. The Germanic emperor, Frederick of Hohenstaufen, who was also king of Province Burgundy, king of the Romans, king of Jerusalem, king of Sicily, welcomed, at his court, in Palermo, scholars from all over the world, in particular scholars from the Muslim world. As Frederick of Hohenstaufen had a great interest in mathematics, he proposed to Fibonacci to be part of his court.
Dissemination of knowledge, between fear, reluctance, and enchantment, in Pisa, Fibonacci came up against a mentality that was initially resistant to change. The dissemination of Indo-Arabic numerals was even banned in some cities, such as Florence. The Arabic name for zero, el-sifr, was the origin of the word zero, zefiro in Italian, and the word shifr in French as dit sifr in German. The mysterious side of the Indo-Arabic numbers shines through in the sense of number equals secret code. Deciphering equals decoding. Although the Indo-Arabic numeration was known in Europe to a few initiates in the 10th century, it was essentially the various manuscripts of Leonardo Fibonacci that contributed to spreading and popularizing the knowledge of Muslim civilization in mathematics in Europe. The works of Leonardo Fibonacci were in the 14th and 15th centuries the main source of treatises on market arithmetic in Europe.
In his preface to Liber Abaci, Fibonacci acknowledged his debt to the scholarly and commercial community of Béjaïa and that of the Mediterranean basin. Europe abandoned Roman numerals and irreversibly adopted the so-called Indo-Arabic numerals. We can even add Maghribis, since it is the Maghribi spelling, slightly different from that of the Middle East. The Arab Muslim civilization bequeathed to the entire planet the numeration system used until today and transmitted the zero invented by Indian mathematicians. The mathematicians of the Arab Muslim civilizational space transformed the so-called positional zero into a mathematical object, which allowed arithmetic operations. These same mathematicians literally invented algebra and were the first to imagine the different processes for solving equations. But are we really aware of this heritage? What would mathematics and physics be worth without Indo-Arabic numbers or a calculation system? What computer program, what automation process could do without algorithm? How many everyday objects work thanks to the calculation system that the Muslim civilization has developed and perfected?